Before I wrote the first word of this story, before I knew that I had a story, before I'd taken any notes, I was haunted by a mood and a vision. And the mood was simply awe at the vastness of the universe, at the beauty and the cruelty it thrusts upon us, and at the strength we can summon to confront its mysteries when we're at our best. And the vision that was a ship, huge, ancient, enchanted, but also intensely real and alive. Like Pozzle and Thasha and Felthrop and the other characters, this ship, the Chathrand, has a soul and a trajectory. She has a past. She's known love and betrayal, war and famine. She has served armies and merchants. One of the great joys I discovered in the writing of this book was that this immense age of the ship began to serve as something of a counterpoint to the youth of the lead characters. And I hope that gives the story both a kind of timelessness and an immediacy at the same time. That's certainly what I try to put before the reader. That this is another world, and it's unfathomably strange, and it's full of demons and time storms and dark sorcery and carnivorous trees, and yet it's also here, right now. It's upon you. It's put its weird little hand on your cheek. In The Night of the Swarm, this long, long story comes full circle. The heroes who were young and naive have become battle-hardened and sharp as swords. The spies have dropped their masks. The villains are out in the open. And there is this mute, terrible force that's been loosed into the world that's beyond the control of any of them. And it's growing, doubling and doubling again. Although it seems that just about everyone wants our heroes dead, they're actually the only ones with a possibility of stopping this swarm. And the best part for me is that they are simply, manifestly, not up to the job. As a reader, there's always this magic trick that I'm hoping a book can pull off, and that is to give me no shelter of denial, to make it impossible for me not to believe, no matter how strange the circumstances. And it doesn't matter if we're talking about an old woman on a park bench, or a young man like Pozzle with this language gift burning inside his brain, or a rat who spars with sorcerers in his dreams, or a warrior priestess like Neda who's losing her faith. Let me see those people. Let me taste their hopes and their terrors, their desires, their weaknesses, their moments of transcendence. Give me that, and maybe your epic sea confrontations and your battles on glaciers and your fights with flame trolls can begin to matter to me. Then and only then. I think readers are going to be very, very surprised at how this story ends. Of course, there are epic battles and cataclysms and world-changing events, but ultimately this is not about blowing up the Death Star. This is about people. I mean, I love these characters, and I hate them sometimes. I dream about them. I lie awake and feel them thinking. I watch them struggle and fail and fall down, despair. I sit beside them until they find the strength to get up, and then I chase after them as they run forward. And I see this quest that they've given themselves to that just takes everything from them mercilessly. as the world that they love is ripped at the seams. And I see them all fighting towards this last little window of light after everything around them has gone dark. I see that, and then I step back and look at what's happened on the page, and if it all feels real, I think I've done a good day's work.